Okay, so welcome everybody to the last session of our traditional Christmas workshop, hybrid edition this year. And now we have Rafael Porto from DESY, who is an expert on gravitational waves and effective field theories. And he's going to tell us about precision gravity from the LHC to LISA and ET Einstein telescope. So Rafael, please, when you want.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Guillermo. Thank you for the invitation. To reiterate that it would have been great to be there in person, and hopefully we're going to do this next time. Okay, let's get started. Oh, no. Why is it moving? Oh, there. Okay, so we have come a long way in our understanding of the evolution of the universe. Since the early universe, we think went through a phase of accelerated expansion, inflation, that created the density perturbations that formed the structure that we observe today, the CMB. That from the galaxies, the black holes that they merge and produce the gravitational waves that we observe with the LIGO Beagle detector. So there's a lot of history there and a lot of understanding that we have accrued during all these decades of studies of the evolution of the cosmos that has led to three Nobel Prizes in the last 5 years. So it's a great time to study astrophysics right now, because as you know, there was the Nobel Prize in 2017. For the detection of gravitational waves to the LIGO-Beagle collaboration represented by those three guys over there. Then there was the Nobel Prize in 2019 to James Peebles for the study of the Big Bang and the evolution of structure formation. And in 2020, as you know, there was also this very peculiar Nobel Prize that was given to Andrea Ghez and Reinhard Genzel for, for the discovery of a supermassive compact object at the center of our galaxy, the observational prize, and also a theoretical prize to Roger Penrose, a hero for all of us theorists that study gravity, for the discovery that black hole formation is a robust prediction of the general theory of relativity. Now, if you notice, if you pay attention to the description, the observational prize does not mention GR or black holes at all. It just says supermassive compact object. And in the case of Roger Penrose's prize, it talks about the theoretical evolution of ideas in general relativity that led to these theorems, the singularity theorems and so on, that talk about collapse and the formation of black holes. Now, how can we marry those two together? This is very unusual that a prize has been given without the name of black hole in the title, like the observational discovery does not mention what the theory has been given for. And if you think about it, if you really want to nail what those supermassive compact objects are, then we need to really probe, because the way that they show that these objects are there is by studying the evolution of stars in the center of the galaxy. We know there's a very compact region that concentrates a lot of mass. Now, whether those are the black holes of GR or not, or any other exotic object, we still don't know. However, and this is the great thing about the nascent field of gravitational wave astronomy, we have seen these objects evolve, coalesce, and merge and produce gravitational waves and detect them by the LIGO-Beagle collaboration. Now, these are not exactly the same black holes that they are sitting in the center of the galaxies, because if you think about the typical frequencies that the merger of supermassive black holes will and the merger of supermassive black holes, what the cutoff frequency for the merger will be, that will be very low. This will be seen by the LISA detector. However, we think that these are all in the same objects, perhaps just a little bit smaller, up to maybe 100 solar masses. But to understand the structure of these objects or whether these are the true black holes of general relativity, we can now start seeing and probing the dynamics of these objects through gravitational wave observations. So as you know, the LIGO-Beagle detector has observed many, many, many binary black holes and binary neutron stars. They are not yet as big as these guys, but maybe up to like there are over 100 solar masses. In fact, now we have even more than one on the same day. So this field of gravitational wave astronomy will explode in the next year also with the next generation detectors, such as the Einstein telescope, which is on the ground, and it will have a much better sensitivity curve to lower frequencies and also higher frequencies, so much longer waveforms and many more signal to noise ratio that will allow us to see even deeper and more events, and LISA in the sky that will ultimately tell us if these guys over here, that the supermassive black holes that have been observed with telescopes so far are indeed the black holes of general relativity or the supermassive compact objects predicted by general relativity, and therefore Roger Penrose will get the observational stamp in his Nobel Prize. But how we can tell? How we can take the gravitational wave data and explore the nature of these compact objects? So this takes me to something that is key in this development of the gravitational wave science, which is the discovery potential, which is the same that happens in almost every field, like the Large Hadron Collider, like when we collide protons in the LHC, is that this discovery potential relies in our ability to make precise theoretical predictions in the theory of general relativity for the dynamics of black holes and neutron star mergers. And in fact, I really like to quote Kip Thorne, and this is 20 plus years, 25, almost 30 years before the first detection. No, the first detection was 2015, but almost 30 years ago, when these people were thinking about the LIGO detector, and Kip Thorne realized that the waveform models that they had at the time were so bad, they knew so little, they couldn't even do the merger phase. Numerical waveforms were non-existent, as you know. The breakthrough came 10 years after, in 2004, 2005. Kip Thorne had this very famous paper in 93 called The Last 3 Minutes. And that is because we see really the last few minutes of the coalescent and merger, because at the frequency, the cutoff frequency, the seismic cutoff at which we start seeing with Earth-based detectors the gravitational wave signals around 10 hertz, that until they merge, black holes of around 10 to 100 solar mass or neutron stars of around 3 solar masses, they last at most a few minutes. So we really see the last few minutes of billions of years of evolution. LISA will see longer waveforms, but with LIGO Virgo, we just see the last few minutes. And that gives us a lot of information. However, at the time, they knew so little about what the predictions of GR were. Kip Thorne was, in this paper, was saying, look, the waveforms will be very complex and carry a lot of information, much more than expected. Improved modeling will be needed for extracting the gravitational waves information. And that's why he was pushing for the theory to go more in the analytic side, in the spiral phase, to understand the waveforms better. But also equally important was to get the merger phase, which is also what we use for the first detection, as you know, which is almost entirely done through numerical relativity, because it was just a few fractions of a second and just 10 order of 10 cycles. But why I like this is because the future, this is a discovery machine. We discover a gravitational wave. We discover that these compact objects are out there in nature. We don't know what they are. And this is the key of this distinction that I'm trying to make. We are now going into understanding the nature of these compact objects. We want to know whether these are the true black holes of GR, whether the standard model is right or not. The Higgs is a composite or is a fundamental particle. We are doing exactly the same thing now with the cosmos, with the black holes that we observe, perhaps even exotic objects, or even understanding, some of you have studied this very deeply, whether these are the primordial black holes produced in a very early era of accelerated expansion in inflation. So the same words I can use right now. We are not ready for the future of gravitational wave astronomy. Even today, when you will see we have done so much better in understanding the dynamics of compact objects in general relativity, the same words can be used today. The future of gravitational wave astronomy relies on precise theoretical predictions. We are not ready, and we have to get more accurate templates. And let me show you what is the challenge. What does it mean to produce more accurate templates? So, for us, and what we observe is the gravitational waves emitted in spiral, which is the early phase of the binary dynamics, that this goes for billions of years. The gravitational wave produced here are very feeble, very weak. There is no chance for us to observe this. However, as they get closer and closer, the gravitational interaction becomes stronger and stronger, and then the gravitational wave starts to pick up. And at some point, which will depend on the masses of the objects and the detectors that we have, whether they can pick up the signal or not, the signal will be strong enough for the amplitude of the gravitational waves emitted to be seen by these interferometers. And then we'll start seeing some initial signal in the detector that will be tracked over some period of time until the merger. When these black holes merge, it rings for a little bit and then it stabilizes. It basically rings down and goes into the final stationary Kerr solution, which then it doesn't emit gravitational waves anymore. So you see the signal entering the detector band, picking up in amplitude and in frequency, merging, and then ringing and going into a stationary phase. Now, for the early part of the Inspira, which, by the way, if you remember, I didn't write it here. If you remember the titles of this paper, so the very first detection was purely merger. was the title said the coalescence of binary black holes. We really saw the very, very, very last few cycles of the binary dynamics, and they merged around 300 Hertz. And it was mostly done through numerical relativity. There was a little bit of attaching the ringing, but not much. However, if you go to the neutron star discovery that was in 2017, this binary neutron star did not merge in the band. What we saw from the binary dynamic was purely in spiral. And that is because the masses are very low. And if you do just naive dimensional analysis, the cutoff frequency was 1/mass. And 1/mass gives you kilohertz for binary neutron stars. And the sensitivity in the kilohertz of the LIGO-PICO detector is not very good. So you don't get to see the merger or the near merger phase of the binary neutron stars when these guys are very light. And therefore, almost the entire waveform for the binary neutron star, all the information that we got for the neutron star, including equation of state, was obtained from the spiral phase. And as we increase in sensitivity and go to lower frequencies and higher frequencies, we're going to have longer waveforms that will have a big chunk of the spiral phase that we need to solve analytically. And why do we have to do this analytically? Because numerical GR is great if you say you have to do up to, say, 100 cycles. A simulation with large mass ratios. I mean, for comparable masses and not spin, you can do a little bit okay with the waveforms that we have. But if you start changing the mass ratio and you start adding spin and precession and more dynamics, numerical waveforms are very costly. It takes months to run one simulation with a mass ratio, say, of 10, and then large spins and not aligned. So it would be unthinkable to produce waveforms that would just rely on running simulations for the thousands of cycles that we need theoretical waveforms for, just on numerical simulations. It would be completely impossible. Take you the age of the universe to run those simulations for 1,000 cycles. So here's with that, we rely on analytic approximations because they're much, much faster. They're approximate, there's not exact solution, but they're much, much faster. We can really run the solution for all parameter space, masses, spins, and in particular also all the internal structure, which is what I'm gonna tell you. And therefore we can then attach that analytical waveform to some numerical simulation. So this is the same as doing, if you're studying QCD and you're doing a lot of perturbative calculations, some effective theory for QCD, say heavy core effective theory, or soft collinear effective theory, non-relativistic QCD, which are the tools that you'll see are gonna enter in my talk. This is using also information from lattice QCD to complement what you have done in the perturbative regime. So here is really, a synergy between different approaches. We, from the analytic side, cannot cover the numerics. The numerics cannot cover the analytics. Now, I'm not gonna talk about it at all in this talk, but there is something to be said also about how you stitch these two together. It's highly non-trivial because GR is very subtle. What we mean by spin variables here, for example, what do we mean by initial conditions? How do we stitch this together? It's highly non-trivial. But let's say there is a way to do this, and some people use something called the effective one-body approach, for example, which is a phenomenological way to merge those things together to construct the waveforms. But there could be a better way to do it, a more systematic way to do it, and I'm going to leave this open for discussion if you guys are interested, because this will be also what will be needed in the future when we narrow the errors made in the systematics and try to construct waveforms. But what I'm going to concentrate the most here is in try to do similarly what we do with electroweak precision data, say, trying to do perturbation theory, say, with electroweak Lagrangian to very high orders in perturbation theory. We want to do the same with gravitational wave physics. We want to construct what I like to call gravitational wave precision data, which is try to solve the two-body problem in general relativity to very high orders in accuracy in the so-called post-Newtonian expansion. That will tell you a bit about what it is, but most of you probably know it's an expansion in the ratios of scales that boils down, because all the scales are related, boils down to an expansion in the relative velocity to high post-Newtonian, to as high as possible. And we will see what we need as we walk along, what orders will teach us about what in the parameters of the source, which is what we want to extract from gravitational wave data. Now, once we have hundreds of events a year, thousands of cycles in band, working at the sensitivity with future detectors, we will need very high accurate waveforms. And this is something that we don't have right now. And this is why we and a bunch of us are very excited about the field of precision gravity, because we need to keep going and construct more accurate waveforms if we want to exploit the sensitivity, the empirical reach of these future detectors, such as the Einstein telescope and LISA. So this is really a talk about the future. In a sense, LIGO, Virgo, we might get better constraints if we use more accurate waveforms, but the signal to noise ratio, at some points we're gonna get like the cosmic variance if we were doing CMB. So we won't be able to get more from LIGO Virgo detectors. But for sure, the future of gravitational wave science, Einstein telescope and LISA, that might not be as far into the future as the next collider in particle physics, we will need more accurate waveforms. And this is why a lot of people are excited about contributing to this field, because ideas from particle physics, which I'm gonna introduce here, have been key to construct the ingredients that go into producing the accurate waveforms, okay? So very good. So where are we right now? What is the state of the art? So this has been a concerted effort. I mean, it didn't start with us. Obviously, the first correction to the binding energy, to the binding potential, the conservative binding potential beyond Newton, was calculated by Einstein, the so-called Einstein-Infeld-Hoffmann potential that was actually calculated by another guy called Droste and communicated by Lorentz, like, I don't know, 15 years before, but then everybody quotes Einstein-Infeld-Hoffmann. It's the first post-Newtonian correction beyond the Newtonian dynamics, just in the conservative sector, without taking into account gravitational wave emission. That would be the first post-Newtonian correction. And then the second post-Newtonian correction came like, I don't know, 30 years afterwards by Chandrasekhar. The third post-Newtonian correction came in the 2000s, and then people started adding the fluxes, because what we need to calculate is how the orbital frequency changes with time. Because if we measure in an interferometer, if we measure the phase, the changes in the evolution in time of the phase of the gravitational wave, the phase of the gravitational wave in particular, because once the binary enters the detector band, it circularizes. So we think that the orbits will be quasi-circular. So the orbital frequency and the frequency of the waves will be related. So if we solve for the orbital frequency very accurately, we can track the phase of the gravitational wave. And the phase is what gives us the mismatch in the time delay between the two arms. That is what the LIGO detectors measure as a phase difference. So the phase is what we are sensitive to, also the amplitude, but mostly the phase. So we have been concentrating, understanding, and tracking the phase to very high level of accuracy, which means tracking the orbital phase of a circular orbit to very high post-Newtonian order. So right now we are at 3.5, almost 4 post-Newtonian order beyond the celebrated quadrupole formula. So this is the quadrupole formula in Einstein paper. This is the quadrupole 3 derivative square. You take away the trace because it's symmetric trace free. As some of you might know, Einstein completely screwed this up. In his first paper, he had even longitudinal modes emitted of gravitons. He then corrected it and removed the traces. He also had a mistake by a factor of 2. He forgot to add the 2 helicity states. But after all those corrections, the quadrupole formula is this celebrated expression that tells us how the orbital frequency changes with time in a period. This is what is also called this adiabatic expansion parameter, which we will use to construct waveform. As long as the radius of the orbit does not shrink too fast, then we can say, okay, we treat the motion as a conservative motion to evaluate some multiple moments to compute a flux. So that's the adiabatic expansion in which we average over orbits. And as long as this parameter is small, we can split the calculation in 2. We get the conservative part, the binding energy in one side, and the forces and the fluxes on this other side. And when you see dots, we plug the conservative part on the dots. Obviously, that is not correct if you go into the merger, because now the time scales are all comparable. And therefore, you cannot average over orbits. You cannot say the flux is evaluated on the average of the conservative solution. However, this is okay as long as I stay in the post-Newtonian expansion. And doing this, we have been doing it over a long time. And I will tell a little bit about this new approach that uses classical Feynman diagrams or classical effective field theory to compute these two elements that I just told you, which are the binding forces and the fluxes, to compute this high accuracy evolution of the orbital frequency that tells us how the phase of the wave evolves with time. And right now we are in 3.5, and the half has to do with including, for example, spin orbit effects. The spin counts with odd powers of B also, because it's not a vector, pseudo vector, so you transform as like V equals to minus B. And the half also account for nonlinear effects in the evolution of the waves, or so-called tail effects, that have to do with the scattering of the radiated waves on the background geometry of the binary. And we are right now almost at 4 p.m. because we have a lot of the spin information up to 4 p.m. We don't have the fluxes yet at 4 p.m. for the spin or the non-spinning part. The spinning part at 4 p.m. we have just finished, and this will be posted soon. The non-spinning part, there is ongoing work in trying to compute what this, how this changes at very high orders, because it won't be just a quadrupole, and it won't be just this formula, because there's a lot of nonlinear effects that one has to incorporate. And 4 p.m. is that the next to next to next to next to leading order, right? So if you come to your friend or your PhD friend who's doing a PhD in theoretical physics, and you tell him, look, I'm doing a four loop calculation, and my advisor told me to do a five loop calculation. It's like trying to do the fine structure construct to six loops. They're gonna come and tell you, are you crazy? Why are you still doing this? Why isn't this good enough? And the answer to that is like, yes, it might be good enough for detection, for saying, oh, we solve this wave and we get some rough idea where the parameters of the sources are. However, if you ask yourself, is this enough for the future of gravitational wave astronomy? Are we really gonna be able to tell whether those are the black holes of GR or some new exotic object that we have never seen before in any other way? Because as it is right now, as this Nobel Prize of 2020, it was given for having a telescope looking at what happens around it, but we have no idea what it is. So how can we tell what this guy is? Well, to know what this guy is, we need to go to higher orders. So for sure, this is not enough. And you should not also, I mean, of course, one might think, if we're doing astrophysics, if you talk to astrophysicists, they want to know how these black holes form. They want to know the neutron stars, the quasar states, the environments, and so on. They might not even care whether they are exotic compact objects, whether these are primordial black holes or not, whether they are like axion-like particles, these gravitational atoms that I tell you a little bit about. So they might just care about the astrophysics. But even for the astrophysics, these waveforms that we have right now are not good enough, because the sensitivity of future detectors, LISA, and the Einstein telescope is so good that the waveforms, the errors that we have right now is completely dominated by theory. We are dominated by theory errors. This is like pre-LHC, and we still don't have high-end accuracy understanding of QCD backgrounds to discover the Higgs. So really, if we don't believe any of the new physics that might be lurking out there, we still need more accurate waveform just to do the astrophysics. And that's not only it. We also need them to discover any new physics out there. Why is that? Because it's very hard to distinguish in gravity what the inner structure of a body is, like to distinguish a neutron star from a black hole. How can we tell that we saw two neutron stars or two black holes? I mean, of course, neutron stars cannot get too heavy because the pressure, the gravitational force will not compensate with the pressure. And therefore, these objects will collapse into a black hole. That's what we think, the Chandrasekhar limit and so on. But if you see a very light object, how do you know? In fact, right now, we don't even know if we saw a neutron star binary, I forgot the number, the name of this event, or a neutron star black hole, or something else. How can we really tell? And the reason it's difficult in gravity to tell is the equivalence principle. The only way you can distinguish a geodesic deviation that will tell you something is compressed more or less, right? It's that the surface of the star compared to the center of mass, right? It's moving differently and therefore is changing in time and producing some quadrupole emission that can also change the waveforms. That is an effect that can only be seen through curvature coupling, because first derivatives in gravity go away, you need second derivatives. And derivatives in a post-Newtonian expansion will cost you factors of 1/r, and 1/r goes like V squared. And then you realize if you start coupling to curvature, the effects of the size, and you see that back reacting in the evolution, that the first time you can tell for sure, unless you have spin, I'll mention spin later, but if these guys are not spinning rapidly, the first order at which you can distinguish a neutron star or black hole is the fifth post-Newtonian order. And that's through what's so-called tidal effects. The tidal deformation of a neutron star, we know about the structure. also the tidal deformation of the black hole, will tell us about where those are the response functions of the tidal deformation, where those are the GR black holes, or maybe something else. Or maybe there is something of an environment, maybe dark matter environment around those black holes that could also leave an imprint in the waveforms if those are compact enough, as long as they can leave an imprint at very high frequencies when those two guys get very close. Because if the environment is very diluted, by the time you get very close, you don't see anything. But if it's compact enough, you might leave an imprint. However, that only centers very late in the evolution of the binary dynamics because it tends to have very high post-Newtonian order. So you have to wait a long time for these effects to actually matter. And will be really seen by future detectors. So it's really a pressing effort for us to get to high level of accuracy because detectors such as Einstein telescope will be very sensitive to these tidal effects that will see deviations from the point particle approximation in which you say this object has no structure. And therefore this becomes a threshold for us of precision. And I just told you we're here and maybe almost here, we still don't have these 5PN effects and which we can tell them apart. For example, the equation of state of neutron stars. Now you might ask me, but wait a second, I read about the question of state of neutron stars in the LIGO-Virgo detectors. How do they do that? And ask me later, otherwise it will take me a little longer to explain. Because what happens is that they, even though the effect enters a 5PN, there is a coefficient, a dimensionless number there, which for neutron stars could be large. And therefore, even though it's a 5PN effect, it could mimic lower order terms, just because there is an enhancement of a dimensionless ratio. And that's what people use, plus matching these coefficients with numerical simulations to construct some phenomenological waveforms where we can put bounds on the equation of state of neutron star. But there's a lot of systematic errors there. We still don't have the waveforms to the level of accuracy in which we can tell for sure that's a black hole, that's a neutron star, or something else entirely. And why this is exciting? This is exciting because black holes do not have tidal response. Black holes have zero quadrupole deformation in the static limit. This is so-called Love numbers. If you take a star and you put it in an external field, it will form a quadrupole, it will squash. And that quadrupole will gravitate and will produce some potential far away. If you look at a neutron star, that potential would depend on how much the star squashes, and that depends on the equation strength of a neutron star. The black hole doesn't want to do that. The black hole remains pristine. It does not deform. Far away, you don't see any effect of a quadrupole deformation. And this is a fine tuning, as we will see, because naturally you will expect this effect to come from some short UB physics to match into some Wilson coefficient of some effective theory, as we will see, and then we have a zero matching coefficient, and it will be a mystery of why that's the case. Now, there has been a lot of development here. I'll be happy to come back to it. But for us, what is important is that there is no standard model background for this effect. That means if we see a binary black hole, a binary compact objects that have a non-zero tidal deformability and a mass which is bigger than a neutron star, I keep saying this, but we go front page of the New York Times because that's a new object in nature. We just saw something that there is no way to match into a neutron star because it's too heavy, or a black hole because it has a tidal deformability that black holes in GR do not. And this is why we are all excited, because this is a handling new physics. What could it be? Well, one thing that it can be are these gravitational atoms. What is a gravitational atom? So we have a condensate of dark matter particles, of ultra-light dark matter particles, massive scalar fields that have a mass of the order of the contour wavelength of astrophysical black holes or supermassive black holes. So there is a range of masses between 10 to the minus 10 and 10 to the minus 20 eV. And those guys can condensate to super radiant stabilities around spinning black holes, extract rotational energy out of the black hole, condensate from these clouds. And this is a paramount example of what a compact object can be that is not just a pure black hole. It's compact enough because the cloud extends, but not too much. And therefore it can leave a signal in a detector that picks up very high frequencies, like 100 hertz, but it's sufficiently extended to produce a tidal deformability. And the tidal parameters could be large for a black hole carrying a cloud. And therefore we can see large deviations if we have very sensitive detectors that can pick up these effects of these clouds. And there is something beautiful that happens is that the companion starts changing the dynamic of the cloud like an atom, like Rabi oscillations. And then we see a lot of dynamical effects on the waveforms produced by the companion on the gravitational atom. So you might be used to hear about, oh, the spin goes down because these guys are rotating fast and then they lose energy to produce the cloud. So by looking at the spin mass distribution, you might constrain these guys. However, that's very indirect. A more direct way to see this guy is to see the shape effects in the waveforms that would be due to the cloud producing a tidal deformability on the waveforms directly. And we have explored this in detail, how these effects will be seen. And they're much, much, much stronger than the effects of the cloud itself emitting gravitational waves, because the cloud is like a lighthouse. It also emits gravitational waves, but they're very weak. And if you go too far, you cannot see them. So the searches that people have looked so far are stochastic. Backgrounds produced by these clouds are very weak. They have to be very close by, and they're very limited. This is a much more direct search that just relies on being able to see these tidal effects, which future detectors will have the sensitivity for, like the Einstein telescope. So this is a window of new physics that we've never seen before. It's completely weakly coupled, so it's very much just gravitationally interacting. It is a range of masses which goes between 10 to the minus 10 to 10 to the minus 20, and it can pick up a whole plethora of possible axion-like particles or any kind of ultralight particle out there that have been captured by black holes and produce these clouds. There is no background because black hole itself will not produce any deformation. All the deformation will come from the cloud, and it will be seen through this tidal effect. So this is a new frontier also for particle physics that pushes us to go to high level of accuracy to explore the nature of these compact objects. And this resembles a lot of what we do in colliders. And we had also with Daniel and collaborators, we had this paper that we like to call gravitational collider physics, because what we do in colliders to pick up the mass and the spin of particles of the products of the collisions of particles in colliders is by studying resonances in the evolution of the probability on the cross sections and the angular distribution. Exactly the same happens here. We studied the gravitational waves, which are the end product of the collision. We also see resonances, and the resonances are caused by the perturber on the cloud. We see resonant effects on the cloud when the orbital frequency kicks the resonance, like in the hydrogen atom between the energy levels of the cloud. We see jumps on the waveforms. And by studying the evolution of the cloud, that will leave a very different imprint on the waveforms, which is kind of like studying the angular dependence. You can learn about the spin of the cloud. The spin is a very subtle effect on the waveforms, the same way that there's a very subtle effects on the cross sections. So this is literally opening a new window into new physics by doing high precision waveforms. But as I have been telling you, we need precise theoretical predictions. We need to distinguish these two guys. And for that, we need to have a very good prediction for the GR, for the red one, which is the GR without the cloud in it, and understanding what the basic effects of the cloud are, like the resonant effects, because something that we don't look for right now. So how do we look for signals right now? We do match filtering. We take one, we take the signal, we take the waveform, we put them together. But if there is something happening in between, there's a very short time of frequency band when you do this integral over frequency for the match filtering. There's an effect that could be very large on one particular frequency, like a resonance, which you will not see it because it integrates to very little in the signal to noise. So you need to look for it. So right now we don't even have the good waveforms that can search for effects that happen at a particular frequency. It is like looking like resonances in the CMB. So you also won't see them unless you're looking for them, right? So like action monodromy that some of you might have worked on. So this is also resembling the same that we do with CMB physics, okay? So this takes me to the remaining of my talk. And I know that this introduction took longer and hopefully I will go faster now. Which is how we do in these calculations. And I think many of you have seen this part of this talk one way or another before, so I will make this introduction a little bit light, but please ask me later if this is too light, okay? I want to emphasize what we've been doing and where we are right now, and what I think the most exciting part of this program, which is that recently we've been learning that the scattering problem, studying the scattering of two black holes or two compact objects, can teach us a lot about the binary, the bound dynamics, can give us a lot of information for the bound case. Even though in principle, it looks like scattering has nothing to do with bound orbits, we have found a dictionary that directly maps scattering information to bound information. And because scattering is much easier to calculate, it also is gauge invariant. You can just compute gauge invariant quantities like an angle, and you don't have to deal with a potential, a gravitational potential, which is gauge dependent, depends on coordinates and whatnot. There's a lot of simplifications in this problem that we can take benefit for this problem. On top of everything, when we do scattering, we can do special relativistic invariants. We can use special relativistic invariants to resum all the velocity corrections at a given order in G Newton, which is the so-called Posman-Kosken expansion. So right now, there is a revolution in understanding this Posman-Kosken expansion and mapping that information to binary systems that has given us a lot of information in post-Newtonian to higher post-Newtonian order. So this is where we are right now. So I'm going to give you a flavor and where we are and where we're heading at. And hopefully we can discuss if you guys have any questions at the end. Okay, so how does this effective theory work? There's a natural separation of scales here because we have the size of the objects, which is say compact objects have a size of the order of GM, that the Schwarzschild radius. You put those two guys far apart, they're still not on top of each other. They're still far apart. So the distance compared to GM, GM over R is of the order of B squared because the typical binding energy. So there is a speed of the order of B squared between these two. And then you build up the wave by moving at a given orbital frequency. So there's also a power of V between V over R, between the typical wavelength that you build, which is longer compared to the distance. And once you see this, you realize that you can construct an effective theory in which you integrate out one scale at a time. We always construct an effective theory in which the binary will be treated as a point-like object coupled to some long wavelength background of gravitational waves and endowed with some higher dimensional operators, some Wilson coefficients, and so on. So it's the same that you will do in any effective theory. The only difference is that the post-Newtonian expansion will break the special relativistic invariants. So you only recover that in a nonlinear way. You don't recover this explicitly. As you will see, there will be a decoupling in space, but not a decoupling in time. The time scale of the variation of the binary and the time scale of the gravitational waves emission is the same. So the object will not decouple in time. They will decouple in space. So that just means that my Wilson coefficients will be time dependent, which you expect to be because the quadrupole moment of the system is changing with time. But that's the only caveat. Everything else goes for the right. And we want to use the same tools that we use in particle physics to solve the potentials and the fluxes in terms of Feynman diagrams to solve the inspiral phase to high level of accuracy. And this is what we do. And let me very briefly tell you how it's done. So we have three scales. So we compute the path integral, we solve for the effective action. Now the effective action, we have contribution from the modes of the gravitational field in all these regions. The regions inside the black hole, the regions between the binary, and the region of the gravitational wave emission. So what we do is we split that integral in modes. This is called mode factorization. So we do one at a time. We first integrate the finite size, then integrate what is called the potential modes, which are the off-shell modes that keep the binding, that keep the system bound together, which are not the on-shell modes. These are like the Coulomb forces, right? Which are not the ones that go on-shell and are emitted. The on-shell modes are the typical ones that have the energy and the time. The K0 is of the order of K. The off-shell modes are quasi-instantaneous, so the time scale is much, much longer than the short-scale physics of the potential. So this R is much longer than typical variation in time of these modes, which is the time scale of variation of the period of the orbit. And then we construct an effective theory. We integrate the full action and construct an effective theory. Now, I don't have to do this integral explicitly because I know how to construct the effective theory just from the symmetries of the long distance physics. For example, let's do the first one. The first one means I have a neutron star. The neutron star has a lot of shit going on inside. All the particles, the neutrons, the protons on the surface, the forces, everything. How can I possibly do this integral with all the degrees of freedom that I have in there, including the binding energy itself of the gravitational field? I don't have to. I know the answer. I know there will be a point particle approximation. We do this in physics 101. We do the spherical cow and we write m d tau, right? This is m d tau. What is that m? That m accounts for all the binding inside the neutron star. All the binding is out this table that I don't need to know, right? The whole point is seeing the corrections. How do we parameterize all the corrections? But it's clear that there is a multiple expansion of the theory that accounts for all the finite size effect. And this is GR, so it's a little more subtle than what we do in Newtonian physics, but it's the same idea. It's MD tau, which we use without thinking since we're little. There's a spin coupling, which this took a while to understand. This was actually my thesis. How do you couple spin in GR to a wall line? Because in GR, often people wrote what is called the Papapetru equations, which tell you how the spin changes in time. It couples to curvature. It's dp d tau r spin velocity, curvature spin velocity. But which Lagrangian gives you that evolution equation? There was none. And then I had to study this and came out with how this couples. It's not very complicated, except for the fact that the spin has too many degrees of freedom. You need 3-4 rotations. And you know that if you have the same that happens with cage theories, right? You have too many, you need cage symmetries. And this you have to study more carefully in GR. But the coupling is very similar to what you do with the Dirac matrices, right? How you couple the spin to curvature with the Dirac equation. So it boils down to be the same, except that you have to be a little bit more careful what this object is. But you can study this very carefully, which I did. And then comes the interesting part. How do we tell these effects apart? Well, the black hole could be rotating, and it could create a quadrupole. In fact, a Kepler hole does have a quadrupole. This effect is coupled to the electric component of the Weyl tensor, and it's a spin square effect. And this, for a black hole, has a matching, which is 1/2. For any other object, this could be between, for a neutron star, could be between 4 and 8. So there's a coefficient here that you can match that will tell you information about the equation state of a neutron star or a black hole. However, neutron stars don't rotate very fast, so you don't expect these guys to be very prominent. You also need the spin to be very high for this effect to be seen, to be observable. The first tidal effect is a curvature square effect, which is what I told you earlier. So the first operator in my world and effective theory that knows about finite size effects is a curvature square effect, a Weyl tensor square, and it's a Weyl tensor because all the traces of Riemann go to zero because the quadrupole response of the deformation induced by the companion is symmetric trace-free in gravity, and therefore there are no traces, and that's why you get the electric component of the Weyl tensor. There is a magnetic component as well. This is the tidal love number, and this is the guy which is zero when you have a black hole in GR. This is the guy that we will see. This is the guy that carries all the information about deviations from GR for exotic compact objects. We have a non-zero value. Clouds, we have a non-zero value. Anything else, we have a non-zero value other than a black hole. This is the physics threshold that we can get at. However, we observe the waves here. So we need to track all this information all the way here to this order to be able to get this guy out. And that's why we still need to do all these steps. However, the information is really coming from the constituents of the binary, leaving an imprint in the waveforms. So we have to carry this all the way to there. So the next mode that we encounter is the potentials. So here we do the integral again. We turn off the gravitational waves because we're doing this adiabatic expansion, which we think about the conservative part of the motion. And therefore we just do iterated Green function. That's what this means. We solve for the metric and plug it back into the action. And the metric is solved by some external source. And the external source are all these guys as a J-phi coupling, as a generalized J-phi coupling on a wall line. And you just do the integral the same way that you study phi box phi plus J-phi. It's just a little bit more complicated. Now, these modes are off-shell. So at the end of the day, the massless propagators of the gravitational field are expanded in P0 over P because the time dependence, the time delay, the retardation is actually very, very small effect. So you can treat it perturbatively for the binding. And therefore, you end up with three-dimensional integrals in 1 over P squared. Here, the I epsilon prescription is irrelevant because naively, you think, wait a second, you're going to start using Feynman. We are in classical physics, you should not be using Feynman prescription. However, for this binding, it doesn't matter. There is nothing going on shell, the I epsilon is irrelevant. The only problem is that you screw up the infrared because you start getting P squares downstairs. So you have to be very careful when you add the P from the radiation that the spoiling of the IR and the spoiling of the UV that will come from the radiation cancels each other, which was one of the big problems in the standard approach of doing this calculation by Planchet, Damu, Schaefer, and collaborators, was having infrared divergences in this calculation. It's just that they didn't understand where it was coming from. And I'll show you in a second what the issue is. But otherwise, it just means doing field theory calculations of sources, turning on sources with Green functions, so 3-level iterations. These are not truly wall lines. These are just sources propagating in time only, so it's not really an actual propagation. You just crank the machine, you plug it into your standard way of doing calculations, and you can get to very, very high order. In fact, very recently, the potential power, the 5 PN, the five loop calculation has been done. And the 4 PN was done relatively recently as well. So now comes the last part, and the last part is the tricky one. How are we gonna include the radiation? And that's tricky because now you have the radiation coupled also to the binding. So you need to separate the radiation from the binding. You need to do a multiple expansion. So that means that once you have this Fourier transform, so you have the Green function e to the IKX, that KX, you multiple expand. So you don't do the full e to the IKX integral, which is very hard. You multiple expand in KX, so you get Ks on top. So you get moments of the same type of integrals times X, 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 and those are multiple moments. So you match now into a multiple expansion. There are some quadruple moments coupled to electric and magnetic fields. It's just that it's time dependent. As I was telling you earlier, there is no decoupling in time. So this will give you time dependent quadruple moments, but it's the same calculation that you did before. You match the TMNU and you span in multiples and you match to your quadruples in the affected theory. And then you square this amplitude or you compute the imaginary part of the self-energy with the Feynman prescription, picks up an imaginary part, this is the total flux. Total flux plus binding energy construct the waveforms and gives you this adiabatic expansion parameter, this orbital change over a period, which is what we use to compute the waveforms during this parallel phase. You crank the machine to very high order in post-Newtonian, and then you don't need to think anymore, except that you have to be very careful because, let me not talk about that. So there is something else which I'll tell you in a second. You have to be very careful here. There is this infrared coming from the potentials, and there will be some UV here. You're clearly spoiling the UV if you put Ks upstairs. You're clearly spoiling the IR if you put Ps downstairs. So you just have to be careful about that. There's another effect that I don't have time to tell you about, which is the scattering off of the potential of the binary itself, which is also contributing to the fluxes. Moreover, it also contributes to the binding energy. There is something beautiful here that I don't have much time to tell you about, which is there's a classical lamp shift in the binding energy of binary black holes that comes from the soft radiation of gravitons coming back and redressing the binding energy of the system because they're scattering off the binding potential. Whereas in the hydrogen atom, what happens here is that the atom interacts with a very soft photon, a one loop calculation is a quantum effect, and this is what gives you the beta logarithm. So here we have also a logarithm, and this logarithm will come from this tail effect, this scattering of the geometry of the soft gravitons. Now you have to be careful, as I told you earlier, to compute the binding energy from the soft radiation, you cannot use Feynman. Feynman will give you fluxes, but it will give you the wrong binding energy because you have to use the correct retarded propagation. So here you have to be careful, you have to go to the Kaldish formalism. You're gonna run into divergences, you're gonna get this UV pulse, but those UV pulse will cancel the IR pulse and everybody will be happy. You don't have any ambiguities and you can predict the answer up to very high order. And these two, for example, is what I just told you. There is an IR from here, there's a UV from here. They cancel beautifully between them and they give us all this 4 PN information that was completed recently, 2 years ago, which is the binding potential. We don't have the fluxes yet. We're still working towards the fluxes. But then you see all these effects that contributed in the 4 PN calculation. A lot of binding from the short modes, a lot of binding also from the low modes, a lot of subtleties between the mixing between IR and UV and everything that goes into the binding energy. Let me show you what the logarithm is and just pinpoint something very nice about this logarithm. So it comes from a completely classical effect. In fact, I wrote a whole paper about it because I thought it was beautiful. It's clearly a logarithm in the binding energy that has nothing to do with a UV logarithm. Naturally, as a field theorist, you see a logarithm, you see it comes from an RG flow. It came from some UV matching. It came from some short distance physics. I just told you the first chance for a UV logarithm comes at 5 PN from the finite size effect because there is no other finite size effects otherwise. This is a 4 PN log, so it cannot be a UV log. It has to be an IR log. And that's why it gave so much trouble to the standard way to do this calculation because they didn't understand where this log was coming from. But for us, it was very clear. It was the same as the lamp shift. In fact, you can do the lamp shift calculation this way and see precisely where this logarithm is coming from. And when you do the calculation of the binding energy from the soft gravitons interacting with this tail, this gravitational potential, you find the same log that you find in the lamp shift. Instead of the phi, the celebrated phi over six that you find in the lamp shift, you find a different number, this 41 over 30. You find a UB pole that will cancel the IR pole from potentials. You put it all together and then you get this binding energy. And we were able to get this without any issue with the ambiguities that the standard approach has, because they don't know how to regularize this infrared divergence from the short distance physics. Whereas for us, there's nothing to regularize. In dimensional regularization, everything just cancels beautiful between IR and UB poles, and the answer just comes out right. And this, I want to emphasize, because in the traditional approaches, there were a lot of ambiguities, a lot of confusion. So this is why the effective theory cleans up a lot of all these calculations. There were different conflicting answers. And they were saying, like Thibault was writing papers saying, you need more than one ambiguity. You need three ambiguities. They always have ambiguities because they didn't understand, or they didn't understand at the time, that it was all coming from this overlap of regions. And the effective theory is very nice to see how this is done. And I did this for the lamp shift, and you see beautifully how the log comes out, how the phi over six comes out, how these poles cancel each other. Now, this is very nice because you get this log, the same as the lamp shift. And if you go back in history, this phi over six also gave a lot of trouble to people back in the day. In fact, even Feynman got it wrong. Feynman was computing the same thing. These are the same diagrams, by the way. But here is the fermion loop. So these are the soft photon and the fermion guy. So Feynman did this calculation. He also understood that he was getting it wrong. He wasn't getting the phi over six correctly. And this guy French and Weisskopf had the right answer, but Feynman told them that they were not, I think the story goes that Feynman told them, no, that you could not be right, I get something else. And then Feynman realized that he was wrong. And he held French from publishing. So that's why then later, you have the lamp shift, you have lamb doing the calculation, beta doing the calculation, even though French, this guy had the answer much earlier. And Dyson as well. So what happened is the Feynman was very confused about this issue of the IRUV, which in this language is a little more subtle about how you do this cutoff in the IR when putting a mass of the photon. But it's the same thing. So don't feel bad if you make this calculation, because even Feynman made it wrong. And it's funny that he put that mistake in a footnote, in footnote 13. He actually picked footnote 13 by leaving footnote 12 empty with nothing, just to point out that he had screwed up. So he admitted it in a very peculiar way. But anyway, so the exact same thing happened for us at 4 p.m. in the binding energy. And then you see the type of subtleties that we observe, all the field theory that went on to do the for loop calculation. We're still computing the fluxes and we have to go to 5 p.m. So that's the next frontier, and we're walking towards that. So clearly I've talked a lot and I don't have much time. Probably you guys are tired. I have no problem continuing, but I'm gonna just talk for 5 minutes, roughly giving you the idea where we are, because this will take me in a completely new direction. And if you're interested, you tell me and I can just return and complete the knowledge of this section. Okay, so okay. Does that sound fair?
Yeah.
Okay, excellent. So if you guys wanna keep listening to me, I can keep talking. So at some point, Guillermo, you tell me stop questions and then we can return, okay? So let me give you the flavor of where we are right now in this other way of exploring the two-body problem, which is the scattering. Why we're interested in scattering? We're interested in scattering because it's much, much simpler. It's much simpler to set up, it's much simpler to calculate, but if you insist on resumming all the special relativistic correction, because scattering is naturally invariant and the special relativity, you naturally get the full green function now, the full 1/p². The problem is that the integrals are gonna be harder. It's much easier to set up, it's very easy to find the integrand. It's just hard to do the integrals. And that's where we are right now, finding a revolution in doing this integration, in finding ways to solve the integration problem, because that's giving us a lot of information about post-Newtonian data, also for the bound case, because we found a map between unbound and unbound physics, okay? And this is what I wanna just give you the flavor of where we are now at the frontier of research in this field, okay? So we're doing the same for scattering. What does that mean? We compute the same effective action. We use the same wall and action that I showed you before. However, we are not doing the potential now. We're not doing the integral of the potential modes to compute the effective action to get the potential, the binding potential. We're computing the impulse. We are solving a trajectory given initial conditions, given well-defined initial conditions. These guys have initial data now. They come in. with some velocity of even parameter and deflect some spin, velocity, impact parameter, and we compute the impulse, which is what this is, the p dot dldx, which is the change in momentum in the scattering. So it's a very different setup, but it's the same calculation. It's exact same calculation, except that we input now some initial data. This data lives in the special relativity flat flat infinity, in infinity, where we input the velocities, impact parameter, and spin. So we can say, okay, these guys outside, far away, living in special relativity, they come in and GR makes them, like gravity makes them deflect, but all the information will come from the initial data. And here we can use all the post-Minkowskian manipulations to construct invariants that will give us the answer of the full problem. Even though we went through GR, the initial data basically is all special relativistic invariant. And that will give us a lot of information that resums a lot of velocity corrections at a given order in G Newton. And this is, for example, through the scattering angle, which is computed from the impulse. So we just compute effective action, we plug systematically the deflections into the action, and we compute this impulse. And naturally, we're going to end up with a bunch of integrals. Those integrals will only depend on the initial data, and that initial data can be factored out. You end up with a scalar integral times some initial data, which are special relativistic invariants, for example, products of the velocities, which are the boost factor between the different frames. And that scalar integral is all there is to do. Now, there is a caveat here, which is you still need to do Feynman diagrams. And those Feynman diagrams, though, for scattering are way, way, way simpler than the Feynman diagrams that we need traditionally in scattering with field theories, in cross sections, in particle physics. The reason is because there's a lot of redundancy in GR. And you realize very quickly, first, that you, if we can set up this problem, we can set up the proper time. We can say now that the coordinate time, which is the one that we use to do the binding energy, because the coordinate time is correlated with the clock that we use in infinity as in the detector. Now I'm not caring about that, because now I can use the proper time because I'm computing the angle, the scattering angle, that's my observable. And therefore I just care about the total angle. I can use any parameter to describe the orbit, and the proper time is very useful. The Polyakov action is also very useful because it just gives me a one-point function. So I don't get any wall-like nonlinearity. That simplifies a lot. And then the cubic couplings, which you can build a lot of the information on the action, can also be simplified a lot by using gate fixing freedom, total derivatives, and even if you want field definitions. So you can go a lot, you can get rid of a lot of the redundancy of GR by being clever about your choice of gauge. So there's a revolution in particle physics now by not using gauge-dependent objects at all, by just trying to guess what the amplitude is by building up through unitarity cuts and so on. What I'm saying here is that you can use a little bit of that intuition still to build up the amplitude with Feynman diagrams, but not to make your life too complicated. And as we will see, it's not very complicated. Feynman still rocks and allows us to build up all this without having to take classical limits of amplitudes, which is what the amplitude people are doing. What we need to do now is the same integral that we did before, but in the entire so-called sub-region. We're not going to separate. We're going to do potentials and radiations, and we're going to resum all the velocity corrections in the potentials. Now, there is a caveat here, is that if I want to include this radiation reaction, I need to use the in-in formalism. I also need to do the counter integral. So all these details I'm going to spare you, but you have to be a little bit more careful to get this log that I described before to all orders. But it's doable, it's not a big deal. And we are doing it right now. We have gotten a lot of results. But the big message here is that it all boils down to doing very complicated intervals. But what has been discussed recently, there has been a new way to look at this problem, is that you can use differential equations, which means you take a relativistic integral, you start taking derivatives, and you write a differential equation that this integral obeys. And because, as I told you, the standard data depends just on the velocity, u1 dot u2 is this factor gamma, and it's the only parameter, it's a one scale differential equation that you just need to solve that will give us the answer for those integrals. And people have been studying this recently. There are canonical forms that you can write in terms of logarithms and dilogarithms and polylogarithms, which will give you the answer. And all you need to do is solve the boundary conditions. And lo and behold, those boundary conditions are the PN integrals, because the boundary conditions when the velocity goes to zero are the same PN integrals that we solved before for the post-Newtonian case. So we're basically finding a way to use the post-Newtonian information as a boundary condition of a sort of RG flow of differential equations that give me the answer of the full post-Minkowskian expansion. So it's like kind of bootstrapping the answer to differential equations with boundary conditions of the PN data. This is beautiful stuff, and we have computed a lot doing this. These potential modes give us a lot of information, but as I told you earlier, there's a lot of back reaction effect. So it's not enough to get up to the state of the art, which will be next to next to next in order in the post-Minkowskian expansion, which is 4PM, for post-Minkowskian order. Just take this with a grain of salt. I don't have time to explain to you where we are right now, but we are working towards getting the full next to next to next of four post G to the four correction to the scattering, which is what we need to include also this binding energy effect that I told you earlier. It's not enough just from potential modes. We need to include this radiation reaction. However, we have been done a lot with the potentials at third post-Minkowskian order, and we have solved the problem exactly. And this has given us, it doesn't matter what this function is. This is the P square of the problem, and from the P square, you can get the angle. So say this carries all the information about the scattering angle at third post-Minkowskian order, and that information from the angle, then we can match, for example, in this center of mass momentum. And once you know the center of mass momentum, you can solve the bound problem as well, because all you need to do is change the energy from positive to negative. But as I will tell you in a second, you can also map the angle directly to observables. So the third post-Minkowskian order turned out to be quite simple. It was just a few diagrams. The differential equations were all canonical, and the integrals we had to do were exactly the same that we had before. The state of the art that you might also heard the amplitude people talk about is the fourth post-Minkowskian order. The potential modes are not enough. We have infrared divergences that we encounter the same way that we found before. It's not canonical. We get the elliptic functions inside the answer, and this is becoming really, really subtle. However, it's still missing the radiation reaction part. This form has to cancel the same way that I showed you canceling post-Newtonian. There's a logarithm that has to be added. We have a little bit of this piece already. We know, we understand the structure of this answer. We know it will cancel. We know how this log of the velocity will come. I know this is going over the head of many people right now, but I'm telling you, we are controlling a lot of the four post-Minkowskian order by understanding how these differential equations carry the information of the velocity at a G at order G4 from both the local forces and the binding and the sorry and the soft contribution to the binding energy. This is becoming really, really subtle because there's IRUV mixing, there's different regions contribute. So I'm not gonna go into that or this or that. Just I'm gonna conclude by telling you, okay, let's say we compute this, we compute the scattering angle, we get some information from the scattering angle. How are we gonna map that? For example, also what people have done with the scattering amplitude to compute observables for bound orbits. And here is another talk, obviously, because it has to do with a revolution that happened also in the people computing scattering amplitudes by matching to a Hamiltonian, by doing a matching of a scattering amplitude gives you a scattering, say a scattering angle, and matching that to some effective potential that gives you the same answer. And then these people, Byrne and company and so on, have, started with Clifford Chan, Ira Rostin, and Michal Solon, understanding at one loop, and then the two loop was this big revolution of understanding how to map that information from scattering amplitudes in the classical limit to some potential, which they gave us in 2019 with these very complicated functions. What we found though, in very recently, we've been experiencing that you don't have to do this. You don't have to do this at all. You don't need to get a potential out of this scattering angle. All the stuff that I told you earlier, how we do this calculation, can be mapped directly to observables. And right now, you're probably watching your computer reading emails and getting a little bit bored, or the excitement is too high that you cannot concentrate anymore. In any case, I know that I'm touching over a lot of different information right now, but the message I wanna give you here is very clear. We need to go to high precision. We are doing a low pass Newtonian. There has been a revolution in understanding scattering from the classical point of view, from the amplitude point of view, to produce an observable like the scattering angle. And what we need, and what we did also here, is how we map that information directly to an observable. And this is something that we understood how to do here. And it was very nice because we found a way to map directly the scattering amplitude to the center of mass momentum. And once you have the center of mass momentum, you can compute all the observables. For example, ignore this for a second, you can compute the radial action. The radial action is an object that is the integral of the momentum that you take derivatives and gives you observables. For example, the scattering angle is the derivative of the radial action with respect to the orbital angular momentum. And then we found there's a beautiful analytic continuation that goes between here, the radial action of the unbound problem to the bound problem, which is just to do an analytic continuation in the binding energy here. And then you go from the radial action of the unbound problem to the radial action of the unbound problem. But you realize what is happening here is really a connection between the endpoints of the motion, because the object is basically the same. You're integrating the same radial momentum between bound or unbound. And we realize with Gregor Kalin also that these endpoints were related. In fact, they're related by analytic continuation. They are the same. The endpoints are literally the same if you do an analytic continuation on the angular momentum. And with this, I'm going to leave it here because this is the beginning of a beautiful story how you connect scattering data to bound orbit, which is the periastron advance and the scattering angle are the same thing. You take the scattering angle and you loop around infinity and you compute the periastron advance in GR. And you can show this to all orders. And it's beautiful. And it's telling us that if you give me the angle, I give you the periastron. If I know the periastron, I can go back and reconstruct the radial action. If I reconstruct the radial action, I get all the information about the binary system. And this is literally what we did. And you can do it also for the fluxes. Ignore this. You can also do it for the fluxes, because how do you compute a flux? You integrate either in a bound orbit or in the scattering. And if those two points are related, they are plus and minus that I told you earlier, and these fluxes are odd, are even under J goes to minus J, then the fluxes are also related. And we found, for example, that the total flux in an elliptic orbit is related to the total flux in a hyperbolic encounter by analytic continuation. So get all the scattering data, use PN as boundary condition, compute all of this in post-Minkowskian, do an analytic continuation, and you get all the data that you need for the bound problem. There's a lot that goes under the hood, but that's basically the message. And let me show you one thing that works beautifully. This is the two-loop periastron advance. And we get it to all post-Newtonian orders in the 1 over J squared expansion, for example, just from the scattering angle. And you can predict all the 1 over J coefficients. So this is really, really beautiful. So this is telling us there's a lot of connection. There's a beautiful story behind the hood here, connecting scattering to bound orbits, computing scattering data using differential equations that look like an RG flow, the post-Newtonian data. A lot of field theory of understanding how IR and UB mix in between short and distant physics, and a lot of high post-Newtonian orders that we can use to construct the waveforms and learn about dark matter, ultralight particles, condensed abrupt black hole. So it's a lot of things to do here with field theory, particle physics techniques, with gravitational wave astronomy that is now starting. So it's really the beginning of a new field where we can contribute in a lot of directions. So I hope I can convey this excitement to you. We need more accurate waveforms. There's a new physics threshold sitting there. There's more energy, more luminosity in the new detectors. We will learn a lot about new physics. We are not ready for the future. The future is really like going from COBE to Planck. LISA and ET will be like going from COBE to Planck. We need more accurate waveforms the same way that we need to understand the CMB. We are not ready for the future. We will get a lot of data that will maybe discover new physics that will go to the front page of the New York Times, and I stop talking right now. Thank you very much for still be listening, and I'm happy to answer questions.
Thanks a lot, Rafael, for the talk, enthusiastic, and with the historical remarks as well. So I'm going to open now the floor for questions, because people were very shy during the talk. Let me also tell you that I have to take a flight quite soon. And so if there are many questions, I may leave in between. And I will leave Josemi, who is also with the camera switch on, to chair the rest of the session, okay? So okay. I see that Juan has a question, I think.
Yes, I do.
Juan, if you wanted.
Thank you. Thank you, Rafael. That was very impressive. I haven't seen so enthusiastic a talk in the last few years, as active as yours. So I have a question with respect to a gravitational memory, right? So imagine you have the scattering of two black holes of each other.
Yes.
If you start same Minkowski, and you get those two black holes to again to infinity after colliding, there will be an offset, you know, in the space-time after those two black holes have passed each other. Now, I don't see yet how in your effective field theory you could see this effect in an actual way, and whether using this duality from bounded to unbounded, you can have any hint of what would the gravitational memory look like in the bounded system.
That's a very good question. The memory is really hard to measure with gravitational waves because, as you know, it's a low zero frequency effect.
Exactly.
So detectors have a cutoff at 10. So it's very hard to see the memory.
Well, LIGO Virgo would probably not see the noise, but LISA and Einstein telescope, you might.
Huh? Exactly. But there is an effect of the memory on the nonlinear back reaction. So there is a nonlinear Christodoulou memory as well. There's a linear memory and there is the nonlinear memory. And the nonlinear memory is the same as this guy. This guy is called tail. This guy here.
Okay.
This is the tail. The nonlinear memory is when this guy here is sourced by the quadrupole. This is sourced by the mass. This is sourced by the quadrupole. And that one is giving us a lot of trouble, right? Uh-huh. It's giving us a lot of trouble because to properly understand the contribution from this memory. So the way we calculate it is this way. It's in the far zone. So the radiation leaves after I get rid of the potential.
After the collision.
It leaves in the far zone. Yeah. So it's a bunch of multiples coupled to gravitational waves. Right. Mm-hmm. So now I integrate out the radiation field in the far zone, and I have these cues, these moments coupled to the radiation field, interacting with the potential or interacting with the radiation itself. So the memory, you know what? I might have it here. Let me show you. Mm-hmm. The memory is a diagram exactly like that, but with the.
Actually, can we have access to all those slides? They are so complicated. I couldn't follow all of it.
This is the memory.
Yeah.
So the memory.
So it's in the nonlinear memory effect, right?
The nonlinear memory.
Yeah.
The nonlinear memory is the same diagram as before, three multiple moments. Mm-hmm. So the answer will have three multiple moments, which is ignore this up here. It is the effective action in the informalism. You have to do an inning that has three multiple moments. Now, the tricky part is understand how you separate this. That has a dissipative part, that the memory changing the fluxes, and the memory changing the binding energy the same way that the tail gave us the beta logarithm.
Okay.
So the beta logarithm gave us a log correction to the binding energy plus a constant from the tail. The memory will not give you any log, but it will give you a constant shift in the binding energy. So this is a way to measure the nonlinear memory in the waveforms by seeing the effect in the flux and the effects on the binding energy, which is at all frequencies. So this is not the same as the linear memory.
Yeah,
which can affect the amplitude, which is much, much harder to measure because it's a very low frequency effect. How do we see it from the field theory point of view? Compute the one-point function. You compute the one-point function, and then you get the Q over R, Q dot dot over R effect. And then the memory is trivial. It's right there. It's a VV effect. It's a Q that has a G Newton and a VV effect. The VV effect is the guy that survives when you integrate over the trajectory. And that's a zero order effect because it's a very low frequency. So when you do this integral, it's a late time. So it basically accumulates. But it's the same, we will calculate the same way that the standard people will calculate it because it's computing the one-point function in the effective theory with multiples. This one is much more interesting because it's a non-linear memory contributing to the binding energy at five Newtonian order that will shift the phase, and the phase we can see right away. Right. So this is an indirect way to see in the memory.
No, it's quite interesting because in the bounded systems, at least you could measure the phase, right? And then you could infer from that what was the corresponding memory effect in second order, linear, nonlinear memory effect in the scattering term.
Yes, the phase is what we really see.
Yeah, that's what you measure.
Exactly. And the amplitude, we do see the amplitude indirectly, by the way, and the effects of the amplitude also Hagen modes. But the leading effects we see are on the face.
So you think we'll see this with LISA?
You know what? That's a very interesting question, whether the memory will be seen. A lot of people, Mark Favata made a career of claiming that you will see the memory.
Yeah.
I'm not so sure.
Okay.
It's very hard to disentangle, you know? But this one for sure we will
see. You mean disentangle from degeneracies with astrophysical phenomena?
Well,
is it inclination angles and things
exactly,
like that?
Exactly. Yeah. You don't know where it comes from.
I understand. Mm-hmm. Thanks a lot, Rafael. That was clear.
So I think Guillermo also wanted to ask a question.
So he asked you to tell him to ask me a question.
Yeah, it's the transition in a sense. And...
Gotcha.
Yeah, so let me ask. My question is very non-technical, but it's a natural curiosity. So you mentioned with tidal deformability, you could explore things that go beyond what we think that we may have detected so far, right?
Yeah.
Particular black holes and neutron stars. And you put the example of the gravitational atom with a cloud of very light axions.
Yeah.
I'm wondering if there are any other well-motivated examples that you could mention, which could also be explored in this way with the tidal deformabilities.
That's a very good question. First of all, any object that has a tidal deformability, non-zero, and is bigger than a neutron star, we don't have any description in astrophysics right now. So, from the point of view of the effective theory, I really don't care what it is, right? As long as I constrain that parameter to be non-zero, for sure I found new physics. Now comes the matching. And if the matching gives me a time-dependent, frequency-dependent effect, which is what I find here, then most likely is this guy, is the gravitational atom. Because the gravitational atom will not be just a constant tidal effect. You will see oscillations, you will see resonances. So then you start looking into what could it be, right? What else could it be, you will ask? Well, if you have a boson star, say you have a scalar field and you put a lambda 5-4 coupling. I mean, this guy condensates around the black hole. Doesn't have to have self-interaction, just gravity will do it out of the rotational degrees of freedom, just the super radiance will extract the energy. But a boson star will not be stable without the self-interaction. So you have to be very careful to build it and make it stable. So you can find solutions, they are not very stable, you have to tune them, but you can find solutions. So in principle, any object made out of any condensate by itself, it doesn't have to have a central black hole. This could be just the condensate of a scalar field, but then you need self-interactions, you need other fields to keep that guy stable. Other things that can be is modified gravity. It could be, it's a black hole of modified GR. I don't believe you can modify GR, but it's possible to look for solutions in massive gravity or bigravity or whatever flavor you like that have no zero tidal deformability. So those could also be probed by measuring this Love numbers. The other thing, which would be the most amazing of all, which I didn't mention because I want to get into this discussion in particular, is the following. A neutron star exists just because of quantum pressure, just because of Pauli's principle. Just because these guys are fermion. If you have a boson star of three bosons, the size of that star will be the counterweight length of a neutron. You only get it because you have repelling forces that you have to put by hand. The repelling force in fermions is quantum mechanics. So a neutron star is 10 kilometers because of quantum mechanics. You take H bar to zero, you get no neutron star. Could it be that a black hole, and I was expecting Cesar to ask this, could be some condensate of gravitons and have a non-zero tidal deformability just because it's not the GR. So GR gets zero tidal effects because the horizon is very special. When you put boundary conditions on the horizon, the same way as the no-Hertz theorem, even though this is not a no-Hertz theorem, because tidal effects occur in six dimensions, for example, and the black hole no-Hertz theorem also runs in six dimensions. You cannot put a quadrupole with flat boundary conditions and spherical symmetry in six, but you can put a tidal Love number in six. So it's not the no-Hertz theorem. But it's very similar. It has to do with boundary conditions on the horizon. But if you smooth the boundary conditions, you make it, for example, a glue ball, some kind of a Mazur fastball, or Cesar and Gia's, whatever that was, could also have a non-zero tidal effect. And it could be kept by quantum pressure or some kind of pressure that makes it very large, the same way that the neutron star is 10 kilometers. This is one way that we can tell if those guys are indeed the true black holes of GR or not. I would have loved to see a calculation of the deformation, the tidal response of those objects, either the fastballs, either skias and Caesars objects, or any other object. Boson stars, it's been done. We know the boson stars have a non-zero tidal response. It gives you a log number, a dimensionless log number, which is the ratio of that parameter over the radius to the fifth, because it scales with 5 powers of the radius, the Wilson coefficient, which is over the 200. The tidal effects of the log number of these atoms, the gravitational atom, could be up to 10,000, could be really, really large, depending on the mass. This object, this fastball, I don't know. It could be non-zero, could be one, could be order one, which would be the natural value of a very compact object of the size of a black hole. But it's not zero. If it's not zero, this is the only way we can tell, by studying how it responds to the perturbation of the companion. And I'm amazed nobody has done these calculations. How do they respond to a perturbation is the zero order question to all these fastballs and whatever, because that's how we will see the effects of the gravitational wave. And these are all the possibilities, modifications of gravity on classical, quantum, on condensates of gravitons, fastballs, firewalls on the horizon scale as well, could be the modification. I don't think so, okay? But could be that also leads to large modifications on horizon scales, boson stars, gravitational atoms, and the unknown that I cannot describe because I have no idea that we could discover just by chance. This is how we're gonna find it.
Okay, thank you. Thanks a lot. I see Savas, right?
Maybe we have a final question by Savas.
Yeah, very quick question. Yeah. Thank you again for the talk. Very interesting. So actually, I have a very brief couple of questions. So the first one is, you said that you don't believe ZR could be modified. Could you elaborate very briefly on this? And the second question is, you mentioned before that numerical relativity codes are quite slow. Are there any theoretical insights we could use to maybe speed them up, or have we reached the plateau and they will never be any faster?
I'm not an expert on numerical relativity. All I know is that the waveforms, the templates are constructed by stitching all this together, right? So you need to have some kind of phenomenological waveform, either through something called phenom NMR, where they use numerical simulation plus post-Newtonian activity together, or effective one-body approach in which you try to construct some parameters that fit simulations. But the catalog of simulations, the simulations that I use to fit the analytic models, are very few, very difficult to run. And once you are spinning large mass ratios and so on, they take a long time. This is what my colleagues tell me the limitations are, because you have to resolve large mass ratios, and that takes a lot of the grid and it takes a lot of time, step. Now, ideally, maybe these theoretical developments with post-Minkowskian could hint at better ways to resum, not just in velocity, but in G-Newton. Maybe we can start seeing how we approach the non-perturbative regime also from the G-Newton side, right?
Yep.
They use a lot of Padre summations. I don't like the Padre summations, but something like that could also help us understand how to use numerical information to aid also analytical waveforms, analytical understanding of the non-perturbative regime. Yep. Now, why the numerics are slow, I have no clue. I'm sure this could be like the CMB pre-Matias. Maybe somebody just have to find a way to do it fast.
Yes.
The line of sight, right?
Yeah,
I don't know. But this, I'm clueless, right? Because all I remember, and I was around, I was doing my PhD around the time France came out with this, is that, I mean, only thing they did was move the mesh, right? I mean, they don't want the singularity, so let's move it, right?
Yeah.
It was such a basic thing. So I'm sure there's a lot more to improve over there.
Yeah. And the brief comment about modifying gravity?
Give me an example. Give me one example of a consistent theory of modifications of gravity that A is not just some effective theory that is supposed to work in some limit. And then you assume that there is some decoupling. You assume that there is some decoupling in some, I don't know, in some regime in which you don't have to invent some bigravity, some other metric to find some stable solutions, where you turn on time dependence and everything goes to hell. It looks like you start building up and constructing more complicated story to create something to solve a problem that wasn't there to begin with. GR is perfectly fine.
Okay, so you're talking in particular about by gravity and massive gravity and so
on. Yeah, come on, what are they trying to achieve? They want to explain the expansion of the universe. That was the original motivation. Of course, the original motivation is, can we do it? Can we start studying massive gravity from the long distance point of view, right? Coupling the same way that we
have the Lagrange. But the thing is, there are also other kinds of modified gravity with higher order invariants and so on, which have their own problems.
RNs are not modified gravity, right?
Sorry?
RN, other curvature couplings to the Einstein-Hilbert action is not modifying gravity, because that is an effective theory. That's just saying that—
Well, it is modified gravity, you can call it as you want.
Yeah, but that means that there is some degrees of freedom at short distance, and you have to give me what you put that cutoff that you removed, and you match into that theory, right? So that doesn't mean that you modify gravity. That just means that you added some scalar mode or a vector mode or a tensor mode that is very massive, very short scale, and you're looking longer, and then you integrate it out and you match into that other theory. The same way that I constructed the log number, my matching the black hole degrees of freedom into my E square operator, you put it a little bit higher. You didn't put it at the scale of a Schwarzschild. You put it a little bit higher, right? A little bit longer in distance, right? And therefore, you match it into the RN, into the bulk action, instead of matching into the wall line. But you're doing the same. You just integrate out some new degrees of freedom coupled to Einstein gravity. That's not modified gravity. That doesn't modify the number of degrees of freedom of the graviton. Gravity still propagates the same way. So I wouldn't call that modified gravity. It's interesting, because there could be, like the gravitational atom, some new physics in between, right? And how do you describe that is a very interesting question. But that I wouldn't call modifications of gravity, real modifications of gravity.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, if there are no more questions, I think we can leave it here. Thanks a lot, Rafael, for the talk. It was super inspiring.
Thank you, guys. And next time we do this in person, I would love
it. Yeah, we really hope so. And well, for everyone, we hope to see you tomorrow for our last day of the Christmas workshop. Have a good evening and see you tomorrow. Ciao, ciao.
See you guys.